Thank you very much, Pat, President. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to acknowledge the presence of my colleagues in the Oireachtas, Deputy Michael McCarthy and Deputy Kevin Humphreys, and Senator Michael Comiskey. I'm pleased to be invited here this morning for this very timely conference, and I hope to offer you some challenging but constructive food for thought as you work through your programme for the day. I know there has been an interruption in the world's food for thought in the last 24 hours, but we look forward certainly to dealing with those matters in an efficient and effective way with the help of the stakeholders and the IFA in the coming weeks to reassure the consumer and reassure the markets of the importance of Irish food and the fact that we have the structures in place in order to deal with a crisis of this modest proportion, hopefully, on this occasion. I suppose I deliberately use the word timely in relation to this conference for two interrelated reasons. The importance of the food and drink sector to the Irish economy has rarely been more evident than in recent years and indeed recent days. It has delivered strong export growth at a time when the economies generally and various business sectors across Europe and beyond are struggling to overcome the sustained recessionary pressures. So from such a position of strength and with further opportunity for growth, particularly on the dairy side, the positive outlook for the agri-food sector is both encouraging and welcome. At the same time, given the size of the sector relative to our overall economy, the impact of agricultural activity on our greenhouse gas emissions profile has emerged as perhaps the most difficult climate policy challenge we face. It is and will remain central to the national effort to make an early and effective transition to a low-carbon, resource-efficient and climate-resilient economy. So I do not believe that it is going too far to say that the achievement of a competitive and environmentally sustainable long-term plan for the Irish agri-food sector would be a defining element of our overall success on transition to a low-carbon future. In my view, the significance of these 2 points, the growth opportunity and the need for it to happen in an environmentally sustainable basis, must not be overlooked or underestimated. They set the broad context for the future of the food sector, a future that will be very different, but one which I believe offers opportunity, at least on a par with the challenge it presents. As is often the case in policy development issues, getting the right balance is the real challenge. From my perspective, you have arrived at a milestone in the history of the agri-food sector. The decisions you take on your future and the preparations that you make to deliver on those decisions will ultimately determine your success or failure in the highly competitive, resource-efficient and low-carbon world of tomorrow. So in your deliberations today and in over the weeks and months ahead, you face 2 specific and very clear challenges. First, the objective which you have set for yourself in Food Harvest 2020 is hugely ambitious, but it is a positive and exciting challenge which, with the determination that I sense across the sector, offers real prospect for a huge reward. But I commend your ambition and I encourage your continued determination. But second, and in parallel to that opportunity and ambition, you face the demanding challenge of ensuring that your success is solidly based in terms of economic and environmental sustainability. So I want to be absolutely frank with you on this point. The imperative of responding to the environmental challenge for your sector is primarily a matter for you, not me. And it is in the best interest of your sector to have a robust and sustainable roadmap worked out sooner rather than later. Yes, of course, policy and regulation will play an important role and the government will not be lacking in that regard. But if you as a sector fail to look beyond a compliance-based approach to protecting the natural resources on which the standards and success of your business and your livelihoods are so dependent, well, I'd find it hard to believe that you will achieve the level of ambition which you've set yourself in Food Harvest 2020. And a further and even greater concern is the real risk that the foundation on which you build growth in the sector in the period to 2020 will prove uncompetitive on environmental grounds in the evolving global green economy. So, of course, environmental protection and sustainable development is a much broader agenda than greenhouse gas mitigation or the urgent need to adapt to the inevitable impacts of climate change. Other pressures exist in relation to waste management, for example, air and water quality. They must all be addressed proactively and progressively if the agri-food sector is to achieve the level of excellence in environmental protection and sustainable development that is likely to be demanded by consumers in the future. And I want to thank the IFA for their very constructive approach to matters relating to groundwater quality in the last year. We didn't want to end up with a fine from the European Commission as we did just before Christmas, But your constructive engagement in this, in order to ensure that people understood from the point of view of your business for the future and your own livelihoods for the future, that we couldn't be achieved without good quality groundwater, and farmers know that better than most. I read with interest a recent article in which Chagas advocated the double dividend of efficiency. It not only reduces the impact of farming on the environment, it also reduces the cost of farming. You may face a demanding, challenging, setting and maintaining world-leading environmental credentials in a global market that must and will change significantly in the period to 2050, but you're not without good advice. Over the last 10 years, Chagas has conducted a comprehensive research programme on farm efficiency, and I very much welcome the focus on that programme on key environmental priorities such as water and soil quality, biodiversity and greenhouse gas mitigation. The policy document, Our Sustainable Future, which was launched by the Taoiseach last June, recognises the substantial progress that has been made to integrate environmental considerations into agriculture, fisheries and forestry policies and activities. However, some immediate and urgent pressures remain to be addressed. In its most recent State of the Environment report, the EPA pointed out that while water quality in Ireland is good relative to other EU member states, we face considerable challenges in meeting the requirements of the Water Framework Directive and other EU legislation. One of the main challenges identified by the agency is the need to tackle diffuse pollution from agricultural activities. This and other opportunities to reinforce your environmental credentials must be taken. A development of particular importance to the agri-food sector is the decision by the European Commission to designate 2013 as the Year of Air. Later in the year, the Commission is expected to bring forward proposals to set the framework for EU air quality management in the next decade or beyond. The critical importance of the air quality agenda for the agri-food sector is underpinned by the added value of high standards of air quality in food production and the fact that ammonia emissions from agricultural activity represents 99% of total ammonia emissions in Ireland. Ammonia emissions cause the formation of fine particulate matter in the atmosphere, which impacts on human health and causes acidification and eutrophication of ecosystems. Protecting our ecosystems is a national priority of particular importance to the agri-food sector. If it's not already the case, it should be central to your growth and environmental sustainability agenda. Last year, as part of the revision of the Gothenburg Protocol, I agreed an ambitious national ammonia ceiling for 2020 and beyond with Minister Coveney. Compliance with that target will be a key criterion in any ex post appraisal of the success of Food Harvest 2020 in delivering on its vision of smart green growth. In the time available, Mr. Chairman, I have just touched on the extent of the demanding challenge you face in ensuring a future for the agri-food sector that is sustainable on economic and environmental grounds. As we make the transition to a resource-efficient, low-carbon future, you must get the competitiveness and the sustainability balance right. They are not mutually exclusive objectives, as borne out by the ammonia agenda. On the one hand, the agricultural sector is the biggest emitter, and you need high environmental standards, including air quality, to support high standards in food production. You have initiated an important and timely discussion on the environmental sustainability of the agri-food sector, and I welcome your initiative, and I look forward to ongoing and constructive engagement with you as your work progresses. I want to turn briefly now to the Climate Policy Development Programme, which I initiated in November 2011. We're just over halfway through the two-year programme, and broadly on schedule. I'd hoped to issue outline heads of a climate bill by the end of last month, but this work has taken slightly longer than expected, but it is at a very advanced stage. And in keeping with the commitment on the policy development programme, I will release the outline heads shortly for consideration by the Oireachtas Joint Committee on the Environment, Culture and the Gaeltachtan stakeholders. Once released, I look forward to the constructive input of all stakeholders to the debate on national policy and legislation, which will be facilitated by Deputy McCarthy and his Oireachtas Committee in response to the outline heads of the bill and the comprehensive policy analysis that has been done by the Secretariat to the National Economic and Social Council. I see Dr. Rory O'Donnell here this morning, and you will be hearing from him on the extensive national climate policy analysis which the NESC Secretariat has done over the last 12 months. I want to take the opportunity to thank Rory and his team for the enormous effort that was clearly involved in compiling the comprehensive interim report, which is already informing progress, and the final report, which has been submitted to me and which will be released in the coming weeks. In parallel with the work under the Policy Development Programme, I'm particularly pleased that significant progress was achieved in both mitigation and adaptation last year. The National Climate Change Adaptation Framework, which I announced in December, provides the policy context for a strategic national adaptation response to the inevitable impacts of climate change. I think we can all agree that individually and collectively, as a society, we must improve our adaptation behaviour and our sustainable behaviour and move towards a more resource-efficient economy. Under the national framework, relevant government departments, agencies and local authorities have been asked to commence the preparation of sectoral and local plans and to publish drafts of these plans by the middle of next year. I expect sectoral adaptation plans to be revised every 5 years in order to ensure resilience to the impacts of climate change. In response to the comprehensive interim policy analysis from the NESC Secretariat, progress on mitigation in 2012 included the extension of the carbon tax to solid fuels and the restructuring of vehicle registration and motor tax. Taxation is not a subject that is well received at the best of times, but both of these measures are key steps in the successful transition to a low-carbon future. The third significant element of the progress achieved last year was a decision by government to mandate a number of sectoral greenhouse gas mitigation plans, or roadmaps. Provisions to give this sectoral mitigation planning process a statutory basis will be included in the outline heads of the Climate Bill. However, there is no need to wait for the legislation to be fully developed and enacted. We know what needs to be done in terms of mitigation planning at a sectoral level, and the government has decided to get on with it. The key sectors are energy, the built environment, transport and agriculture. While virtual zero emissions in 2050 will be the context of the development of sectoral roadmaps in energy and transport and the built environment, a carbon neutral approach is more appropriate in the case of the agricultural sector. The objective is to finalise these sectoral roadmaps, which will include a reasonable period of public consultation in each case by the end of October this year. The sectoral planning process is ambitious in its objectives and its timing, but the roadmaps are urgent. They're an essential first step in developing an overall national 2050 roadmap towards a low-carbon society with a competitive low-carbon economy to be finalised early in 2014. So you'll be hearing more about the sectoral roadmaps and the planning for them over the coming months as the process of rolling out the individual mitigation and adaptation roadmaps progresses. Input from the agri-food sector to the sectoral mitigation roadmap on agriculture will be important, and it will be your opportunity to bring your vision, ambition and determination to bear in defining the parameters of competitive and environmental sustainable sector in a longer term context and mapping out a path to ensure a successful outcome. In the coming weeks, I will, as promised in the Policy Development Programme, release the final policy analysis which I have received from NESC. It's a very impressive piece of analytical work on the longer term national agenda to 2050. Its release will complete the body of national-specific material which I undertook to make available to the Oireachtas Joint Committee for the purposes of its work over the coming months. As I've already mentioned, I look forward to both the constructive input of all stakeholders to the debate, which will be facilitated by the Oireachtas Committee. So from the outset of the policy development process, I've made it clear there are no easy answers to the challenges we face. And of particular relevance in this regard is the fact that our national greenhouse gas emissions profile is fundamentally different to all other EU member states. Policies and measures we adopt must respond to our national circumstances as reflected in our greenhouse gas profile and the structure of our economy. We can, of course, learn from policy and legislative responses in other countries, but as I pointed out previously, it would be folly to think that what works elsewhere provides an easier and appropriate solution for Ireland. As a one-size-fits-all approach simply will not work. We must shape our own destiny and make progress on the basis of what will work best for Ireland in meeting our greenhouse gas mitigation obligations in the medium and long term, and in pursuing the new growth opportunities in a context of a low-carbon future. So against that background, my intention is to ensure that the ultimate policy decisions on the way forward will be taken on the basis of a fair hearing for all stakeholders and will enjoy the broad national consensus and support of an enlightened and progressive society. In addressing the size of the agri-food sector relative to our overall economy, I already mentioned the impact of agricultural activity in our greenhouse gas emissions profile as perhaps the most difficult climate policy challenge we face. Consequently, I believe that the planned sectoral mitigation roadmap on agriculture will be one of the most important policy documents on the sector in recent times. In drawing up that mitigation roadmap, it will be important to bear in mind that while livestock emissions are accountable under our legally binding reduction commitment for 2020, the related inventory sector, land use change and forestry, or LULUCF, is still subject to a policy gap in the international process under the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change and under EU law. As a consequence, we do not have a complete process or methodology to evaluate and address the overall impact of greenhouse emissions and removals from the type of open pasture farming predominantly practiced in Ireland. How that policy gap is addressed in our sectoral mitigation roadmap will, in my view, be critical in terms of the influence which we can and must bring to bear and how it is ultimately addressed within the EU and at a wider international level under the UN Convention process. The policy gap issue is a matter of profound importance to the future of the agri-food sector and its perceived impact on the environment. At present, under both the Kyoto Protocol and EU law, agricultural activity is regarded as having an entirely negative impact on atmospheric greenhouse gas concentrations. No allowance is made for emissions and removals in agricultural soils. But in recent years, we and other parties to the international process with similar concerns, such as France and New Zealand, have invested heavily in trying to mobilise an international work programme on agriculture and climate change. Progress has been slow and limited, and there is no immediate sign of the substantive programme of work getting underway, or whether the outcome will lead to a more complete approach to agricultural activity, capturing the inherent link between livestock and land in countries like Ireland. So in these circumstances, the question arises as to whether an incomplete policy context under both the Kyoto Protocol and the EU law presents an appropriate basis for a mature and progressive sector to develop a long-term plan on competitiveness and environmental sustainability in a low-carbon world. It is a critical, important question in the context of the long-term future of the agri-food sector. While respecting our commitment to the international process under the UN Convention and our obligations under international and EU law, I believe the sector has an opportunity to look beyond the policy gap and demonstrate international leadership in a sectoral mitigation roadmap for 2050. President, ladies and gentlemen, at the outset, I promised you some challenging but constructive food for thought. I hope you now see that you really are at a milestone in the history of the agri-food sector and that you have some critically important decisions to make about your future. If you wish to be a leading sector in the resource-efficient, low-carbon world of tomorrow, you must demonstrate unquestionable credentials that underpin excellence in environmental sustainability. Otherwise, your prospects of achieving your own ambition under Food Harvest 2020 would be compromised from the outset. The reframing agenda set out in the NEST Secretariat's interim report is very clear on the need to think for yourselves, as the report says, to move beyond a compliance-centric approach is to see international institutions and arrangements as a framework within which Ireland works out an effective course of action that is suited to our context and is in the spirit of the international drive to manage climate change. It is a demanding challenge, and the need for excellence in environmental sustainability applies across the whole environment agenda. In the context of your deliberations today, your response as a sector must include a 2050 vision and a mitigation plan for the sector that is consistent with the highest efficiency in food production and the lowest impact in terms of carbon intensity. Where international policy is not yet fully developed, the challenge of setting out your long-term vision and plan is your opportunity to inform and positively influence the wider international policy development process. I wish you well in your deliberations today and in your critically important input to the development of the sectoral mitigation roadmap for the agricultural sector in the weeks and months ahead. Thank you very much.